aka disorders of sex development. Before we can really talk about and understand intersex, we have to talk about sex. Are you ready to get your science on? I sure hope so. Sex has four primary characteristics. Your genitals, on the outside, your sex organs, on the inside, your chromosomes, part of your DNA, and your hormones, which are secreted by your glands into your blood. These primary sex characteristics are typically present when you're born, and they work together to produce your secondary sex characteristics. Those come a little later, during that notorious hormone party known as puberty. Secondary sex characteristics are things like chest hair, facial hair, pubic hair, larynx size, which determines the pitch of your voice, height, menstruation, muscle to body fat ratio, a whole bunch of stuff. Based on what we observe, human beings sort ourselves into two sex categories, male and female. But as it turns out, there are actually more than two sexes, and that brings us to intersex. Intersex is an umbrella term. It's used to describe people who don't fit into the typical definitions of male and female because of variations in their sex characteristics. About one in every 2,000 people is intersex, and there are lots of different forms of it. Genital variation. The person might have a fused labia, a very tiny penis, or a very large clitoris. Sex organ variation. The ovaries may not be fully developed, or there's something of a vulva on the outside and testes on the inside. Chromosomes. A person might have a penis and XX chromosomes, or XX Y or X or XX and XY. All the X's and a little bit of Y. And hormones. Their cells may not respond to testosterone. Now, when you take all these variations that can happen into account, it's easier to see how sex is actually a continuum with male and female at the ends. It's not just two strict categories, right? A little word about categories. Our brains naturally categorize things. It helps us to simplify information so that we can more easily draw conclusions about the world and save our brains a lot of energy. But it's important to remember the sex categories of male and female are actually generalizations, and those generalizations are created by us, by humans. These generalizations are sometimes medically helpful, particularly when we're talking about things like puberty, pregnancy, menopause, menstruation, your risk for certain diseases and cancers, you know, breast cancer, prostate cancer, heart disease. All of those things are affected by your sex. But there's still no boundary, there's no checklist about what qualifies someone as female or male. And that has created a whole lot of problems for people who exist on the sex continuum. When a beautiful little intersex baby comes into the world, doctors and parents are eager to assign it a sex and a gender. These assignments are based on babies' genitals, whether they have something that looks more like a clitoris or more like a penis. Now, for some intersex conditions, you can't even tell by looking. You know, it might be chromosomal and the person doesn't know till much later in their life. So they get assigned male or female and they go on their way. But if it's not so readily obvious, doctors will just sort of arbitrarily pick a sex, usually based on whether or not they think that your genitals could penetrate something that is what makes a male. Which, when you think about it, is a really weird standard. More so in the past, but still to this day, doctors will perform surgery on infants to make their genitals look more normal. And that is a big problem. One, an infant can't give informed consent. Two, there is really no normal. Even dyadic genitals, which fit into the sex binary, have so much variation. Three, and this is key, there's typically no medical need to operate. And four, it can compromise the person's sexual pleasure, functioning, and sense of agency down the road. For these reasons and more, it's crucial to leave intersex babies' genitals alone if there's no medical necessity. So what's with the surgeries anyway? Intersex gives people a lot of anxiety because it poses this paradox. People think that sex and gender are the same thing, when really, they are two different things. Sex, male, female, intersex, pertains to biology, even though the ways that we understand that biology is socially constructed. Gender, on the other hand, refers to the interactions between our psychology, our culture and socialization, and our identities. But in a society where sex and gender are treated as the same thing, if a parent can't discern their child's sex, they can't discern their child's gender. And that poses a lot of social, cultural questions about how they will raise the child. And this is an important question that I think all parents should ask themselves, not just the parents of intersex children. How can we raise children without strictly prescribed gender roles, without all these expectations based on their genitals? I'm a challenge for you, internet. I wanna know what y'all think down below. Love y'all very much. Mwah! I'll see you next time.
Except your mom. Oh.
What?